much for coming to Table Talk. I think this is our sixth episode, and as you can see, we've got Pastor Phil back for round two. Thanks for coming, Pastor.
Thanks, Sean. Thank you for having me back.
Well, the people had spoken after our last session. They were all on me about getting round two, so okay. Thanks for agreeing. Had to twist his arm, force him a little, but he's here.
I hope I don't disappoint you.
No, it's going to be great. I know it's going to be really good. Obviously, we heard Pastor's testimony during the last Table Talk session that he was with us. So we're going to launch straight in with our topic that we want to discuss tonight. And I really believe it's going to be helpful for all of us because it's something that we really need if we're going to be effective and successful in life. And at the moment, we're in a little bit of an uncertain season as people. And so we really believe that now more than ever, while the future is blurry, that we really do try to contend for vision for our lives, for our families, and ultimately for our church. And the truth is, we never end up anywhere good in life on purpose. We need to be intentional if we're going to accomplish anything great. So we're going to talk about vision for our lives and for our leadership and for our families and everything that's involved. And so Pastor Field is going to draw from the well of wisdom tonight, no pressure. And we're going to talk about vision because the Bible tells us very clearly that without a vision, the people perish. And we don't want to perish. We want to go places and succeed. And so we're going to talk about this important topic of vision tonight. So Pastor, launching in with the first question, I think the term vision, it can lack substance for some people. What would be your description and definition of vision?
I think vision for me personally, I appreciate it's a biblical word and it's one that we throw around a lot in Christianity. But for me personally, when I think about vision, it's imagining, it's seeing something in my mind's eye that is possible, that there's potential to do it. I actually, just the way that I'm wired and how God made me is I will visualize things. I'm just one of those people that I can kind of see a piece of land and imagine the house there or imagine what they could put on it, or I can look at a church building and start to... I think that there is a certain personal crafting that would come into that. Yeah. But I guess in terms of a principle, which I think is the point of your question, is really a vision is visualizing something. It's not there, but you know that it can be there. And you're the one that's going to have to do the groundwork and go about the process of getting that thing done. That's to me, when somebody talks about vision, it's seeing what could be and seeing what can be.
Yeah, absolutely. And that definitely applies to all areas of life, doesn't it? Your marriage,
everything.
What it can be, our health, our finances, and definitely spirituality and our walk with God. That's the wonderful thing about Christianity. It's not about who we are, but who we can become. So I appreciate that description. I think for some people, sometimes scripting it and maybe establishing clear vision is a struggle. It can be something that's just in their minds. They see it there and they go, okay, yeah, I can kind of see
it. Great idea or something.
Yeah, but how do you establish or script clear vision?
Are you asking how do you then tackle it? How do you go about it when you say by script it?
I think, you know, talking about some practical steps for how we accomplish it, we'll consider a little bit later, but I guess establishing the clarity, do we write it down?
I see. Okay,
because
I
if it's just
your
in our mind, it could get lost.
Look, I do understand that often, for example, if you went to a financial seminar or if you read The Barefoot Investor, the book about money, various things, often, yes, advice is given and they say write it down. In fact, I forget the stats. I think they say that 80% of people who don't write it down never really accomplish it. And so I'm sure there's incredible merit in writing it down. I think for myself, though, it's probably something that I begin to speak.
Okay.
I'm a talker and I'm fairly open like you are. I vocalize things. That's who I am. Mm-hmm. And so definitely, I think when you start to speak about it, which without sounding too spiritual, biblically, that's what they would do.
Yeah.
They would start to speak about, and that's why your words are very powerful, because if you don't begin to say, this can be done and we could do this, and that's why when you get around people that talk like that, they're very inspiring because they make you feel like it can be done.
Yeah.
So I think to use that word script, yes, writing it down, but I think perhaps speaking it out as well and repeating it. And then, of course, in spiritual terms, that's what praying about it is. Mm. One of the things that I have a vision for our church in Strathpine is to have our own building one day.
Yep.
And almost every morning I pray about that. And then sometimes in prayer, I get specific to the nth degree. How many people it would house, how many car park, you know, I've got this list of things, but because you speak it out, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth, you believe in the heart. Mm. So I think writing it down, yes, but I think to speak about it is very good too.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you think surrounding yourself with like-minded people that support your vision is important?
Oh, absolutely, because they're going to, well, again, they're going to talk about it, aren't they?
Yeah.
Which is why I think what I'm saying about speaking, I know over the years with Kerry, I will tell her almost without exception this great idea I've got, like what I'm thinking about it, can it be this, and I'm already visualizing it, I'm already well down the road in the end result being the accelerator, which is what a husband's meant to be, and of course she'll often be the handbrake, the brake, and like you know, we'll look immediately reminded of all the realities and things to watch out for. But yes, of course, surround yourself around with people, and I think that if you're ever in a place of responsibility, it's wise to do that anyway, surround yourself, and not just with yes men.
Yeah.
You got to surround yourself with people who are clear thinkers, and doesn't mean that you've got to accept every opinion and idea, but they can definitely throw something into the pool that is very, very helpful. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, well, I can definitely testify of you speaking things out. I remember many, many, many years ago, 10 years ago, and you would speak into the Strathpine Church what it would become. Which it has now.
Yes.
You know, you said it was going to, we're going to plant churches and we're going to accomplish certain things which were non-existent back then on a Wednesday night when there were, you know, 20 people in church.
Yep.
To what it is today and the churches that are out, you spoke that into existence before it ever existed. And so I definitely think that that's great advice to begin to communicate it and speak it. One of the things that I like to do is just write it down somewhere where I see it all the time.
Yep.
It's kind of like the person who puts a picture of their house on the fridge that they want to buy in the future, and every time they see it, they speak about it, it inspires, and that's definitely something that I think is important as well. Success and progression in life sometimes can present us with opportunities, but at the same time, what I've found is sometimes those opportunities that present themselves, they can actually be distractions masquerading themselves as an opportunity. How do you differentiate between godly vision, God's will for our life, or just our preferences?
That's a great question. I think, first of all, the will of God is in the Word of God. So contained within the Bible, and I don't profess to be an incredible theologian at all, but my basic, simple understanding of Christianity is that what God has asked all of us to do is in His Word. So if it's something that falls beyond the parameters of what he says, well, we know that's probably not God's will. That can be our own idea. I think that with that as well, because God's a good God, is he's able to close doors and he's able to open doors. So sometimes I think all of us may consider pursuing things that are not his will. Sometimes we might even pursue things, not just consider them, but actually do it. Mm. They're not his will. He has ways of closing those doors and turning us back to where we need to be. God really is a sovereign God who's able to orchestrate, you know, I think the details of our lives. I hope that's answering your question. I'm not sure if you were looking for a spiritual, maybe more practical answer.
Oh, a bit of both, whatever you want to throw out.
Okay, all right. All right, well, I think the second thing then that I'd have to add is that, and this is me knowing me and everyone's different, but I really am a very visionary, idealistic kind of, you know, come up with things, creative. And I'm aware that not all the things I want to do, as you know, which is why you've asked the question, are not going to be God's will. So I guess it's learning to discern as well.
Mm.
Sometimes those things that present themselves, you need to really ask yourself with discernment, is this really what God wants me to do, or is this just what I want to do? Which I do appreciate, it's the point of your question. But I think that another thing that can help is having friends. The Bible says there's wisdom in the multitude of counselors. Mm. Maybe sometimes some of our great ideas are harebrained ideas, and having some brothers or sisters, and certainly a pastor, often can bring a nice sober balance to things.
Yeah.
I've mentioned our spouse. If we're married, I think that God blesses a man with a wife who is a helpmeet. She will at times be very correct, may not be always correct, but there's times that she'll be very on the money and very timely in her response to maybe what our ideas are. But I think having some friends is very important, some brothers too, that you might bounce it off and throw it out there. Sometimes I might say, you know what, that's a good idea, but you lost your mind. That's don't do that.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, absolutely. For you, you lived as a missionary for 10 years in South Africa with your family, pioneered two churches over there. Obviously, that was God's will. You said God's will, God's plan is in his word. I like that. That's cool. How did you get to a place of knowing with certainty that South Africa was the will of God, the plan of God? And Where did that vision to become a missionary in a third world nation originate?
Okay. I'll try not to be long-winded, and I really mean that.
I'll take your time.
Yeah. First of all, the burden to be a missionary is obviously something that the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, just placed in my heart. You hear preaching, you hear about other nations, and it was clearly in my life, I know, God was just dealing with me, a phrase we use probably too often, but really did begin to address me. Now, at the time, I was pastoring a very good church in Bunbury in Western Australia. Congregation was more than 100 people that had churches out. I was full-time. But God began to just disturb me, and God will do that. God will trouble you when he's wanting to get your attention. Because Bunbury was a beautiful town, lovely beaches, it had all going on, but I was kind of oblivious to it because my heart was already being moved. So first of all, I think it's important to say that. For me though, that's where the struggle began, because I said, Lord, I'll go overseas, I want to be a missionary, but where do you want me to go? And I did have the privilege to preach in a few countries, England, Russia, Indonesia, there was a number of places, but I found myself every time going there, saying, oh Lord, is this the country? Is this the place? Mm. And I never really got any witness. And it was really by, I shouldn't say accident, by, again, it was sovereignly how God did it, but I went to preach in Zimbabwe and Zambia in the continent of Africa, and you have to pass through Johannesburg, which is the hub for airline travel in Africa, which meant I had to pass through South Africa. And I'd thought about South Africa, but I'd literally crossed it off my list because so many couples were going there when apartheid ended. And there was something in me that said, no, I want to go somewhere where nobody's been. I'm not going to South Africa. They're all going there. So when I passed through South Africa, and I was literally only there for a couple of days, kind of a bit like a boxer, I'd actually dropped my guard. I wasn't thinking about South Africa. Within 24 hours of being there or less, I just knew that I knew. God just dealt with me, said, this is the country I want you to come to.
Wow.
Now, if I can add something to that, after the fact, though, I ended up in South Africa. In fact, I went back for a second visit before I really did migrate there with my family. Mm. But then what came back to me was, I remember two things. One, somehow as a kid, hearing about this country of South Africa, I don't know how that was, but I was aware of it. And I'd grown up with black people, primarily Aboriginal people. The second thing was, when there used to be a very popular magazine called Time Magazine, this is before internet, and a lot of people would read Time Magazine to try and keep up with the world. And I remember when South Africa had their first elections, and I was looking at photographs of South Africa in the Time Magazine, and it was aerial shots of people queued up to vote, black people, and then some close-ups. And I remember my heart was moved when I saw the pictures. And I realized that for years of my life, God was always setting me up to go to that country, and particularly because it's so diverse racially and the tension, but because I'd grown up with Aboriginal people, I already had some insight into. So I can see where God, remember I was saying earlier about God will close doors, open doors? God really did almost trip me over into that one.
Yeah. So when you were in South Africa, obviously you'd now made the journey across with your family. What was it like when you began the church? You were obviously in a foreign nation. You had never been there before or lived there, the particular place that you started the church, King Williamstown. How did you see the church come to fruition? Because to lead us on that journey, what did you see? The people, the crime, the backgrounds of the community, and how did you see what it is today before it was there?
All right, again, I'll try not to be long-winded. King Williamstown was just a wild town, and because before I was saved, I lived a bit of a wild life. I've always liked to live on the edge.
Yeah.
I've always liked the adrenaline, and if it was a bit scary, I liked that. It's a bit weird, I know. As I got older, I'm probably not so much so. However, back to King Williamstown, like any endeavor for God, I had about eight, almost 9 years experience. I think it was about 8 years when I went there. I'd been pastoring for 8 years when I went there. So I'd learned some things as a pastor.
Yeah.
But really, it was just finding out and trying things. And I'll give you an example. The very first outreach I did, it was in a black suburb, what they call a location called Ginsburg. Highly racial. In fact, if you've ever heard of Steve Biko and the story Cry Freedom, he grew up in that suburb in King Williamstown. In fact, he was married and lived there with his kids when the apartheid government arrested him and took him away to Port Elizabeth. So this is a very, they hate white people. Well, I did my first outreach on there on Saturday night in the hall in Ginsburg.
Wow.
And I remember taking the PA and setting it up to show a film. And when I got there, there were two black guys boxing. And I had to go and say, listen, fellas, I booked the hall. You're going to have to leave. This is my hall tonight. And I mean, then they did. I've got a heavy accent. I'm not even from there. And the outreach that night was so terrible. Mostly kids came. They screamed. They trashed the place. I didn't even give an altar call confession, to be honest with you. At the end, I just said, new church starting in town here. If you want to come, here's the address. And I was so mad. And I just packed up the gear, went home. And so without me being long-winded, I just tried things.
Yeah.
So I would just do an outreach here, an outreach there. And what was quite distinctive about the place is the people lived in their culture in the location. So if they were coloured, which is a culture, they lived in one suburb or area. If they were black, they lived in Ginsburg and they lived in Swalecha. And so I started doing outreach in these places, but then I realised very quickly, if I set the church up in one of those areas, they'll be the only people I get. Mm. So that's why I decided I'm just going to be in the town centre. And that I literally started right in the middle of town and attracted all different cultures.
Wow.
So to be honest, it's trial and error. A lot of things I tried didn't work. Some things did work. But really, it was just the same basic principles that we do in any church, you doing here in Underwood, we do in Strathpine. Yeah. It's preaching, loving people, visiting them, caring for them, doing Bible studies. Mm. Praying, establishing prayer, establishing dominion, just the same things and making plenty of mistakes.
Yeah. One last question regarding South Africa, and then we can go on to other things. When you look back at your time there, what are the most monumental or moving or standout situations? It's polar opposite. It went from one thing to another because of vision. Can you think of anything?
There are many. There's so many. You know, we could be here for a long time. But the thrill of seeing God build a church, I mean, it was incredible. I had so many people coming. I didn't know who they were. I didn't know their names. I didn't know who was connected. I didn't know who was married. I didn't know who wasn't married. I didn't know who had HIV. A lot of people dying from AIDS. It was just incredible as God just kept bringing people and bringing people. And it was something he was doing, and they were coming. And not because I'm a great preacher, but they were coming because of the preaching. Mm. And they would come week after week, and they'd tell other people, and they were coming. And it was the first, probably the greatest, one of the greater experiences I've ever had, way, way beyond ever preaching in a conference, was preaching and entering like a whole nother zone where the Holy Spirit was taking the sermon in a direction and just saying things that he loved these people and wanted to help these people.
Yeah.
The thrill of that. Seeing the transformation of these people, black people who hated white people, having a white pastor, seeing white people get saved and begin to love and serve black people in the church.
Wow.
It was phenomenal what God did, seeing that thing grow. And I might add, God challenging me about a lot of my own Pharisaical religious mindsets that I'd embraced in only 8 years of being a pastor.
Yeah.
God confronting that and challenging that and humbling me and saying, listen, my word says this, why do you think that? Or what? I don't know if that's making sense for you, but it was so unique. It was precious.
Awesome.
It was incredible. I mean, there's so much. I mean, it was wild. It was like a movie. There was so much crime. I saw dead people every single month. Every month I saw dead people in the town, from shootings and from murders and car rollovers and just, when a taxi rolls over there, 30 people die, you know.
Yeah.
It made life in Australia seem like Bambi in the in the green pastures, you know, in comparison.
Yeah.
But I loved it because where sin abounds, grace abounds much more.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, sitting under your preaching as your disciple for 10 years-ish, even though I've been out for a bit, but, you know, hearing much of your preaching for 10 years, hearing literally hundreds of your sermons. Horses in South Africa, they top the list of illustrations, so I've heard many, and dogs, I've heard many stories of what God has done during your time there, and, you know, the restored relationships, young, troubled teenagers, being absolutely transformed, now pastoring churches, leaders, you know, people who had, you know, scattered minds and are stable, people who were bad with money and are managing money, they paid for their own building.
Yeah.
Those sort of things are incredible. One of the things that always stands out to me is the street lights in the street story.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I'll share that for sure. Yeah, what happened was, I think this is very important, actually. It's a great illustration of vision. You know, we say about vision is visualizing something. From the day I got there, every single South African told me when I said, I'll be doing three services a week. And it's saying, and night times, Wednesday night, Sunday night. Every 100% of people told me, you won't get anybody going here Sunday night. No, people do not go out at night. Now, literally, they were correct because it was so dangerous that once it was dark, people were indoors. Wow. But I remember just within myself saying, no, I'm not going to believe that. I'm going to believe that God can build a church because that's what we do. Yeah. So there was certainly a certain amount of probably even maybe arrogance in my faith.
Old faith.
Yeah. But I realized that because it's dangerous and I've got to do something about it. So the street that the building is in that we rented for a year, then we bought, didn't have street lights. So I did a couple of things. One was I put lights all around the building. I paid someone to come and help do that. Secondly, I paid a permanent car guard to be there. So they have like a uniform and everything and a stick and a gun. So if you came to church with your car, and I put that on all the flyers, car security. But the third thing I did was I tracked down the head of the electrical commission in the area, went to his home actually, and knocked on his door. He was a white fella. And told him, listen, I'm in Berkeley Street, King Williamstown. We don't have any traffic. There's no street lights. It's dark and dangerous. I'm just wondering. This man, within 10 days, put in an order, and they put street lights all the way down the street. In fact, he said, because that building you're in is a heritage building, he said, we'll even put a spotlight on the pole across the road, and that'll shoot onto your building. And of course, we're not paying for the electricity because this is all the local commission. So we had, it was like the circus was in town.
That's awesome.
But honestly, it was literally God just helping us all the way.
Yeah, I love that.
So,
2/3 of your services were nighttime. So, you know,
correct.
That's a discouraging reality. You get there, you think you're going to build this great church, and to be told by so many people it's not going to work, no one's going to come, that would have almost robbed the momentum, but vision.
Yeah.
Prevailed. I love that.
Actually, can I just tell you this too? What happened was one of the first Sunday night services ever. I had this young man and his wife coming, and they had like a little ute. They parked it right at the front door under the street with the most lights you could possibly get. The rubbish truck came by. I kid you not, the rubbish blokes smashed the window on his car and stole a Kentucky Fried Chicken off the seat and just kept going.
It's crazy.
I mean, I went and lodged complaints. It was like the devil was just determined that you're not gonna do this, but you just gotta push past those things.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that's vision.
Well, you just mentioned then you gotta push past those things. That feels like a bit of a step or a strategy, and that's kind of what I want to talk about now. Maybe some practical steps and strategies for fulfilling vision. What would some be?
I think that number one, you have to expect a lot of obstacles. There's gonna be a lot of roadblocks. And that sometimes it just takes sheer grit, guts, and determination to just keep going. When you don't want to do it, you want to give up, it hurts, you're discouraged, you're tired, you're fed up. But I know with me through the years, and sometimes maybe almost a little foolishly, but I've just kept going. I've just not given up. So I think that's one thing. I think the second one is you must know you are going to have opposition from people. There's always going to be detractors, there's always going to be critics, there's always people who know better. And that's scriptural. I think maybe even our last table talk, we mentioned when Jeremiah was building the walls around Jerusalem, he had people there criticized. They wrote letters, they said things, whatever, whatever. So not everyone's going to be excited always about your ideas. In fact, some people are going to be in their mind, and they're probably not ill-conceived always, but they just might be very much opposed to what you want to do. So you've got to be prepared to push past that. So I think, you know, guts and determination is critical. Number two, understand you're going to have obstacles. And then I think number three is you've got to believe if God's involved in this. Again, remember we said earlier, if the will of God's in the Word of God, and we know, for example, you talked about a church there. If God wants to have a church there, we know that's His will. Well, He's got your back. He's the one that's going to help us get the job done. Mm-hmm. And truthfully, I think in spite of us, God often makes us successful.
Mm. I think that's pretty interesting, all three of your responses there. They all kind of have something to do with your mental approach.
Yes.
If we become overwhelmed mentally, and we actually talked about that last time, we processing did. Pain and yep. you know, difficult things in our minds. If we can't knuckle down and have that grit, understand there could be opposition, and have ultimately faith, which is what you concluded with there, then vision likely will not be fulfilled.
Yeah,
absolutely. Maybe we can now talk, because those are some strategies, I guess, that we need to be mm. aware of, and I'm sure there's a myriad yeah. of other practical strategies.
Can yeah. I add a fourth one to that list
yeah,
of three? Just I promise I'll be quick. I think the fourth one is you must again make sure too you got some friends.
Yeah.
You've got some people that can kind of encourage you on, because it's amazing how sometimes when someone can just give a word of in season of encouragement that reminds you that it's okay. That, you know what, you are worthy, you are doing a good job, you are getting there, because the devil doesn't ever let us think that. Mm. He'll bombard our mind with negativity, but it's amazing how just you only need one or two good friends, which is often can be even a wife, as we've mentioned, but I think for a man it's more than that, or a woman it's more than that. It's just having a couple of friends that'll believe in you and say that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, sorry, anyway, you're no. going to your question.
No, that's awesome. That's absolutely true, and I think, you know, one of the things that is really important from tonight is, you know, I kind of want to just put it out there to our congregation that, as we said earlier, communicating, speaking about vision, even scripting it, as in writing it down, putting it somewhere where you can see it so that you can look back to it and understand that's where we're going, that's what we want to achieve. And then having faith, knowing that there could be some opposition, surrounding yourself with the right people, all of those things are so important and effective steps and strategies. What about hurdles though? Because as much as we speak about it, we can have it plastered everywhere, we could print it on a t-shirt, you know, and surround ourselves with people that are gonna empower us towards pursuing vision. What would some hurdles and some opposition be to strategy and vision?
One that comes to mind is definitely money. There's few things you'll ever try and do in life that there's money involved in doing it. And as whether it's pioneering a church, raising your children well, having a strong marriage, money's a reality for everybody.
Yeah.
I think the second one is hurdle to overcome is the weariness, the tiredness.
Okay. So like physical limitations.
Yeah. I think all of us just, we all have the propensity to just become very weary and tired and worn out. Which is why to have a break, I think you've got to learn to pace yourself, which, and I only say that in hindsight, because I've not been any good at that at all. I've been absolutely dreadful, confession. Mm. Because if you have a determined nature, there's something in you that at times that you rely on your determination, and maybe you rely on it too much. But maybe times when you're tired, you actually just need a rest and a break. And then determination kicks back in again, which, for example, I think is why a lot of you very good athletes, some of these top rugby players, for example, they allow them to have off in a season X amount of weeks, or say they're a test player, the club lets them miss so many games. Or when the season starts back, the captain or the veteran players, they often let them come to training later than the younger players because they can rest their body. Mm. I think that another hurdle to overcome is the weariness and the tiredness. So number one is money. Number two is the weariness and tiredness. And then I think number three is discouragement. There's no doubt about it that when you're really trying to achieve some things, and if I could give you some from my own heart in-house in recent years, we've been really trying, striving to get a piece of land, to get a building as a church. Yeah. And it's just been absolutely just wears you down and you just get discouraged. But you've got to, you can't, discouragement is failure of the will. And this is what I so often pray for people in our congregation who are discouraged, it's a loss of courage, and I'll pray God put courage back in the heart of the discouraged people.
Yeah.
And so courage is, you know what, we can do this again. I'm going to get up. And I think over the years, I've found that that's what I need to do. I just need to get hold of God. I need to get off on my own sometimes. I need to just take stock of things. And then I just need to come back out with guns blazing again.
Yeah.
So I think definitely you've got to get past discouragement by having a replenishment of courage.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. And that will kind of lead us into our next question now, because speaking about discouragement being a hindrance or a hurdle to vision, what do you do if you have maybe given into a temptation, or as we alluded to earlier, a distraction, and you've deviated from your vision and you feel like a failure and you are discouraged? How do you recover and get back on the path of the vision?
You know, I think if I had the perfect answer to that question, I'd probably be extremely wealthy. But I think for me personally, I guess it's coming back to, I know that if I do God's will, and I know I should do God's will, at the end of the day, you really are serving yourself. And so if I'll get back to doing what I'm supposed to be doing, everything's going to work out and I'm going to benefit again. And I think it bears mentioning for everybody tonight, there's not a single person except for Jesus who doesn't make mistakes.
Yeah.
And every one of us fail, every one of us drop the ball. Sometimes we fail worse than others. And I think some of the incredible examples we have in Scripture, they're not there so we can beat them up. But if you take Peter, who is my namesake, for example, I mean, he failed pretty bad. Mm. I mean, we're talking about, no, I don't know Jesus, beep, beep, beep. The list goes on and on and on. I mean, Jesus has taught him how to love people. And the very night they come to get Jesus, what does he do? Peter jumps out, gets his sword out, and hacks the unsaved bloke's ear off.
Yeah.
I mean, powerful evangelism, Pete. But I guess the point is, there's not a single Christian who's achieved anything that the entire journey, it was checkered with failure.
Mm.
Failure is commonplace to everybody.
Yeah.
And if you don't think that, you're just full of pride.
Yeah.
And I think for myself, I know in spite of Peter, God's done what he's done.
Mm.
I mean, I look over the years and I appreciate when people, you know, they mention achievements you've had and what you've done. But I mean this with all genuine humility. I really do know who I am. And I know in spite of me, God has done what he's done.
Yeah.
I look at my family and my children. It's in spite of me as a father. I'm not the best parent of all. But in spite of us often, God will still do what he wants to do.
Yeah.
So I encourage you tonight, whoever you are, you're listening, you're watching on, because I appreciate we're really out of time. If you've made mistakes, hey, listen, join the club. And that was why Paul said, he said, I'm the chief of all sinners.
Yep.
And he wrote that as a Christian, yep. not as a sinner.
Mm. Yeah, awesome. That's great encouragement. So that would be encouraging people who have failed, who are perhaps deviated away from the vision. It'll help them get back on track. It'll help them regain focus towards pursuing the vision for their lives and their future, or whatever it is they're giving themselves to. Last question. How would you encourage people to believe in themselves and to believe in their future?
Well, it sounds unfortunately a little repetitious or even cliché-ish. But you have to see yourself in God's word, because God really does see every single person as very precious, very valuable. And with all of our failures, with all of our shortcomings, we really are just clay that he's working in.
Mm.
And so you've got to see yourself as God sees you, and not as the world sees you, not as other people who know you see you. And I may have shared this story, I'm sure I have, from the pulpit. You've heard it, maybe others. Part of my testimony is that I was married before I was a Christian, and my marriage didn't even make 2 years. My first wife took off and I was at work one day. I've never seen her again. If you're watching, I'm very sorry, I was a terrible husband.
Yeah.
But I've never seen her to this day. But I remember when I felt called to preach and I began to give myself as a disciple, and I had this reoccurring nightmare. And in the nightmare, I'm preaching in a hall somewhere, and there's all people there. And next thing, she walks in the back door. And she's astonished and she's angry. She can see it's me preaching. And she starts to yell out, from the back. She says, you know, do you know who this is that you're listening to? Do you know what he's done? And there's like when moment stands still, time stands still rather for a moment, and it's embarrassing. And then normally I'd wake up from the nightmare. And it really did balk me for a long time to really just saying, okay, I'll go and do this, I'll be a preacher. And what set me free was when I came to the conclusion that if and should that ever happen, at that point, I am going to say to the crowd, she's right. In fact, there's a lot of things that she may not even have said here today that I am ashamed of that I did. But the only reason why I qualify to preach is because I'm forgiven and my righteousness is in Jesus. There is nothing righteous about me.
Wow.
And I think that you've got to see yourself how God sees you, because we are broken vessels.
Yeah.
That's my simple answer.
That is awesome. That's powerful. I know the story, but I've never heard you really phrase it like that, with that sincerity and that self-reflective perspective. And I value that. And I think it's so true that when we know who we are, it helps us know what we're not.
Yeah. That's right.
And I think when we know who we are according to God's word, it empowers us and it helps us to pursue what God has for us. And that's what I love about our church and what we are striving to do, and obviously as a replica, a baby from the Strathpine Church, and that is to give people hope for their future, that they can come into our congregation broken, messed up, with no direction, but through the grace of God, which is what you were just referring to. It's nothing but grace. But through the grace of God, they can go on and accomplish incredible things. I was a high school failure. I had a very limited vocabulary when I came into church, hated authority, didn't like people, was incredibly self-centered.
Yeah.
And to be in the place that I am today, it's because people like yourself saw vision, had
potential,
saw vision for my life and my future, and helping me believe and accept, and then embrace and strategize and plan towards and submit to and overcome discouragement, has seen things materialize over time.
Can I make one final comment?
Yeah.
Sean, whoever you are tonight, you're listening, you're watching, can I say this? You're going to feel like giving up a lot of times, but don't. Just keep going to church, another service, another day, another week, just whatever you do, you don't quit. If you don't quit, believe me, you have no idea what God's going to do with your life. And that's why he brought you to this congregation. Or perhaps if you watch on live stream, this has become your church. Can I tell you, just keep going. Just don't quit. God bless you.
Absolutely. And on that note, we're going to conclude. But thank you so much, Pastor.
Thank you for having me.
Very grateful for your time. And church, as Pastor just very eloquently said, let's not quit. I'm looking forward to us getting out of COVID-19, the restrictions, and being together really soon. Let's keep praying that will happen very, very quickly. But until then, let's keep striving for what God has for us. Let's enlarge our vision for ourselves, for our church, for our community, and let's give ourselves to it and see what God will do. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you real soon.
God bless. And sing the stars to